And then there's actually things that enhance movie performance. So those are dynamic HDR, quick media switching, and enhanced audio return channel. Now, dynamic HDR, I see a whole bunch of Dolby Vision in the comment page. And Dolby Vision is a version of dynamic metadata, just like HDR 10 Plus. As I mentioned, all, with the exception of HLG, all HDR is based on SD2084, or what's called PQ, perceptual quantization is the fancy name for that. But Dolby Vision is a third-party system that adds dynamic metadata to tell the TV how to optimize itself frame by frame by frame. HDR 10 just has static metadata, which means if I'm looking at this movie, that static metadata looks at the brightest pixel in the entire movie, in this scene from Harrison Ford. And what is the brightest frame in this entire movie, which may be this image of Harrison Ford. And it tells the TV, here is the brightest pixel in the entire movie, 3,700 nits. And the brightest frame in this movie averaged about 475. And then so the TV tries to adapt its parameters, what it can do for color and brightness to match that frame. However, this is the frame to the picture to the left is another example of an image or a scene in this movie. And now the TV is using this bright information to optimize this dark scene, which can make scenes look darker and colors look flat. When you have dynamic metadata, every frame, every scene of the movie provides that information to the TV so it can adapt itself. So that's what HDR 10 Plus does, and that's what Dolby Vision does. Dynamic metadata here is another version of dynamic. This dynamic HDR we're talking about here, that's part of the standard, is an open source version. So you can have a display that can support HDR 10, Dolby Vision, and this dynamic metadata standard. Okay, so that is what that is. On next, we have what's called quick media switching. And what this is we've all seen it where you have a menu system on a TV, and then you switch to the movie. And when you go from the menu system in Netflix to the movie that's 24p, you get a blackout. That is because when you go the old standard, HDMI 2.0b, when you went from one frame rate to another, they had to re-authenticate their rights, which meant you had a blackout, a blank screen. Now, when you're switching from one frame rate to another, it does not have to do that anymore. One of the things that happened is if you think about the Apple TV, the problem when the Apple TV first came out was they were concerned that when you went from the Apple TV menu to a movie, the customer would see that blackout as a problem or that the display was broken. So what an Apple TV does out of the box is take everything and upgrade it to 4K 60p HDR. So if you're watching, I don't know, Citizen Kane, it's going to take that and make that HDR 60p. If you're watching Apocalypse Now, instead of 24p SDR, it's 60p HDR, which we know is going to mess up the picture. So now they added this thing called match frame rate and match format, which means leave the menu at 60p, but whenever you see SDR, or whatever you, or HDR, or different frame rate, 24p or 30p, switch to the proper format. But now you get the blackout on the screen. With quick media switching, that goes away, okay, on devices that support it, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then lastly, I feel like I'm just ranting and raving.
Great, though.
Enhanced audio return channel. So audio return channel and enhanced audio return channel both support the Dolby surround sound formats available, including Atmos and DTS:X. The difference between ARC and eARC is in ARC, your multi-channel slash and your object-based is compressed because of how the system sends the signal down the line. With eARC, the multi-channel and the object-based for Dolby Vision, DTS:X, is uncompressed, which is why you, because it uses a different line in the HDMI cable. That's why it says HDMI and HDMI with Ethernet. So they can send more data. So it's like comparing a, a CD to a high-res file. They're both two-channel, except for one has compressed, the channels are more compressed than the other. So when you go from EARC to ARC, you don't get more surround modes. You don't get more surround formats. You just get less compressed. You get uncompressed channels of information. All right? So, and this is actually critical because, say, for example, you have multiple devices that are 2.1. You can plug one into the TV because you want it to be close to the TV so you can change the disc, and you can send that audio back at uncompressed, the highest quality that that game system can send. The same quality as a 4K Ultra HD Blu-ray back to the receiver, and I can have another device plugged into the TV. The other thing is most 8K or high frame rate stuff that's going to be shown, it's probably going to, because there's no third-party devices except for game systems that support it, will probably be internal apps, like maybe like YouTube, Netflix, or some Sony or LG or Samsung proprietary video service in their TV. Well, you have all that beautiful 8K content. The way that you send that audio from that TV's internal device at its highest quality is going to require EARC. So this is available as well. And Jake, how long have we supported EARC on Marantz receivers?
For Marantz and Denon receivers, we have been supporting them since last year. So this is the second year going in.
Exactly. So I have a couple of pieces in my house, Denon and Marantz, and my pieces that I've had over the last 2 years. Because until I get a game system that needs more than that I have to physically connect to the back of the receiver, because of auto low latency mode in EARC, those receivers will live for a little bit of time. You know? Exactly. But like I said, the reason why you buy the new model is, yes, you get the 8K, but I'm still going to want to buy a new Denon receiver just from the other things we're going to talk about after we get out of this video conversation, because those alone are going to make you want to buy this receiver.